Welcome to the Hold My Spot podcast. My name is Ethan.
And I'm Matt.
We typically go to concerts and tell you all about them.
Yeah, but a little bit of a concert drought right now in Cleveland, Ohio in February.
Apparently it's winter in Cleveland, so we're going to prep for maybe our biggest concert of the year.
Yeah, this is going to be our biggest overlap in our musical genre tastes.
Yeah.
The band that speaks most to us.
Emotionally, spiritually,
physically,
sexually.
Probably sexually.
We'll find out by the end of, maybe not this episode, but maybe the Enema of the State episode.
Absolutely. And obviously the band we're talking about is Blink-182.
Yeah.
We scored some fantastic tickets to this show and we are really excited about it.
Yeah.
I saw them in 2018 or 2019 when they were touring with Matt Skiba.
You need to brag
from Alkaline Trio. Okay, sorry, Ethan.
Wow. You have wallpaper or is it just all Blink?
That's everywhere? In my other bedroom, you know, just where I go to meditate.
In your shrine room?
That's right, yeah.
I don't want to
have some candles.
Yeah,
Buddha shaped candles and Cheshire cat in there.
So you're getting back in it. It's my
first
Blink concert.
Yeah.
You know, just a 30-year-old man seeing Blink live for the first time.
Yeah.
Reserve your judgment. But yeah, we figured it'd be kind of cool to get ready for the May concert in Cleveland by just working our way through every Blink album to date. And we're going to go chronologically.
Yeah, we're going to just sort of go through some of the songs and give some of our insight, I guess, some of our feelings about the songs.
Yeah, you have a lot of feelings.
I do have a lot of feelings.
I think ire is what comes to mind for me. Resentment.
I wouldn't say that. But
we'll dig into it. We'll get to the bottom of it.
Yeah.
There actually might be love.
There's definitely love. Yeah. I mean, everything. I like the different eras of Blink. I mean, obviously in Buddha and Cheshire Cat and, you know, it's just very much more of like a punk album. And then it morphs later on with Enema of the State into more of like that pop punk.
You're like, okay, this is nice, good punky stuff, but come back to me when you're an LLC,
all right?
Come back to me
more refined.
When you're a taxable entity, all right? Get it figured out, get a manager. Get an LLC and then come back to
me. That's right. Yeah. Get in a movie, you know, go get in an American Pie movie.
Get intertwined
talk
with
to me.
Skateboarder of America.
Yeah.
Intertwined in the culture. But yeah, Cheshire Cat is what we're starting, right? The first Blink album. We know it's
full
not. Full album, right? We know it's not.
Not
we don't
a
wanna,
demo, EP.
What's the name of Blink fans? Blinkheads? I want to speak to them.
I actually don't even
second.
Know.
We'll go with
Sounds right.
Well, yeah.
So should be. Blink if it's heads. Not, it should be.
Blinkheads. Yeah, we get it. It's not the first recording. They were recording stuff as far back as like 1993 or something, some crappy demo tapes, some of which became Buddha. Well, maybe I'm the one who has ire.
Crappy.
Jeez, that was that was a Freudian slip
right there.
We're just
going to end this right now.
I just told on myself.
You were projecting that feeling onto me.
I think I was. I think I was carrying that on my drive over here.
Disappointed.
Not to die.
I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed.
I'm sorry, dude.
Take a breath. Recollect. And let's go.
Do what I always do when I recollect.
Yeah.
For ASMR purposes, if I can get...
We'll
I didn't even clip my fingernails yet, so I should be able to get into this just fine. Wait. I hope that's caught well.
Had to have been. It's perfect.
Yeah. Well, oh. Wow.
Mm.
Won't even cheers me before you sip.
Yeah.
Thirsty
Forget about chivalry.
There. You just started recollecting quickly before I did.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we're thinking Cheshire Cat. We're just going to go through it song by song. We might not listen to every song. We've been listening to it a lot this week. Maybe get through a verse chorus and just give you our reactions. Feel free to listen along. We're going to be playing the music with you. So hopefully we can have a good time here. Crack open maybe a Miller High Life.
Perhaps a Cutwater or another seltzer.
Labels out.
That's right.
Labels out.
Brought to you by, not really, but maybe someday.
Maybe Mamitas.
Maybe Mamitas. Maybe Cutwater.
Yeah.
Maybe Miller. Maybe Budweiser.
For the gluten intolerant, of course.
That's right. Uh-oh, just lost Bluetooth connection here.
This is
technical difficulties.
It's borderline romantic, the way that you and I are going to listen to this. It's like we're watching a rom-com together on your MacBook Pro, sharing the same headphones and maybe the same heart.
Definitely.
For maybe just a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So any final thoughts, any final words, any final regrets?
No, I'm excited. I mean,
dig in.
I can without a doubt say that Enema of the State, like so many other Blink fans, like that is my favorite album. I don't haven't really listened to Cheshire Cat a lot recently, but definitely another great album. But
I'm
you know, everybody's got their roots and
I'm with you. It's certainly not how I found them.
No, definitely not.
This is this type of stuff that for me, you dig into years after the fact.
Yeah.
After you've already heard all the big hits, you know, the songs and you just want to dig further into the discography.
Yeah, I wish I would have been there in, 1995 when this came out, but I was 93 years old.
You were busy. Right. Like you were just figuring out.
And I had this full beard too the whole time.
Yeah.
You know,
those were troubling times.
They were very confused.
No time to recollect, crack open a High Life, which was or was not around. I think the champagne and beers has been around at least since the 1800s.
Definitely. A long time.
So that probably wasn't an issue. Yeah.
Yeah. There were plenty of Blink fans enjoying that and listening to Cheshire Cat in 1995.
Which is funny, the whole Blink fans thing, right? Because they were named Blink.
Right.
They had to give it up for some funk group that really
didn't do much with them. They were in Europe, right?
And yeah. Nothing really happened with them.
Never bothered to look up any of their songs.
Yeah. Maybe that should be a bonus thing. Maybe we should check out and see if the original Blink does have some songs in Spotify. I'd be down to check it out.
Yeah, for sure.
See what all the fuss is about.
I kind of love the lore about the name, too. Like, where did Blink 182 come from?
So they swear that 182 is meaningless. I swear.
I do not buy this. I was talking to somebody else, and we were debating
What's
this.
Your theory, then?
I don't know. I think that...
You have a theory. You think about it in your shrine room.
That's true.
Candles lit, that's naked.
True. That's true. And what I came up with, I was spiritually enlightened.
Mm-hmm.
And what the universe was telling me is that they're not telling us what 182 means.
Maybe there's not telling you because there's nothing there.
Maybe. You never know.
Listen.
But the universe told me there's something there. So.
Well, you're a good listener.
But well, maybe not. I don't know.
Universe might have drank one too many Miller High Lifes.
That's true.
May have got sponsored too young an age.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think one of the theories, one of the prevailing theories was it was Mark's target weight to be 182 pounds, not kilos. This is not that
US
type of podcast.
Fans only.
This is not that type of a podcast. Pounds. I think what was the other theory?
The amount of times that Al Pacino said the F word in Scarface. Just him, though, not
is
the
that,
whole movie.
Is that the actual number?
I don't know.
I've never seen Scarface, nor I guess did, I probably wouldn't sit there and like count.
All right, podcast is over. We're going to go watch Scarface. Everybody else, hang on for a minute.
Hold on, I'm practicing my counting. Six. Yeah, to get to 182 would be like, that's a whole separate problem for us watching Scarface.
I didn't look up the number that they say it, but if the movie is 2 hours long, that's like saying it, I don't know, once every 45 seconds, something like that.
Yeah, at least 45 times a second. It's a strong pace.
Which wouldn't surprise me. I mean, it is that prevalent in that movie.
At least 53 times a minute. Maybe we'll never get to the bottom of what the 182 is all about, but... wouldn't that be nice if, I don't know how many songs they have across their entire albums, their entire discography.
Oh, yeah.
I would think that they're very close to 182. What if they just, that was it?
I mean, 18, most albums are what, 12 to 15
They've
songs?
They've been ranging, I was looking at it, they range closer to 14 to 16 on average.
That's 10 albums.
So what if like 182... It's just it. And then they all die.
They just retire.
In a tragic dildo accident, which I think would be apropos for
I think
their
they
sense
would
of humor.
Even. Yeah.
I think that's how they want it to happen in a tragic. I don't think Travis would have anything to do with it.
No.
I think he's completely separate from their debauchery, but I think Mark and Tom.
No,
would
I think
die.
He's involved, but it's just, I think it's.
I just,
definitely
yeah, I just
driven
don't think he'd
Mark
partake in any dildo related incidents.
I hope not. I don't want to picture
No judgment. It's just.
All right. So anyway, Cheshire Cat, huh?
All right, enough dildo talk.
All right, so we kick off Cheshire Cat with Carousel, which was on Buddha as a demo.
Yes. Going to be a lot of overlap, right?
Yeah,
I mean, it seems like they took the best stuff they had from Carousel. They got to the studio. It was a small indie label that fronted them the money to record this. And yeah, I think they did well in their selections from Buddha.
Definitely. Yeah, definitely. Although I don't see, I think one of my favorite songs from Buddha was 21.
And yeah.
I didn't see that.
I was hoping that would have made it across.
Yeah. So maybe they had to leave one good one, one really good one behind.
As we learned from our interview with Snow Ellett, your artists don't always like the same songs that you like.
Right.
Which is weird because, like, I don't know. Wouldn't you want to assume that your artists love all their songs?
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be kind of weird if they didn't? If they put something out and they're like, ugh.
I mean, I think there's plenty of artists that maybe love the song in the beginning and then they had to play it 7 million times in front of crowds.
That's
true. And
then
learn to hate it. It
can lose its luster like anything. That would be actually impressive, right? You could do a world tour with a song.
Yeah.
And then at the end of it,
300
still
shows.
Feel something.
Out of the year.
Feel something that resembles joy about it.
Yeah. So anyway, let's kick it off with Carousel.
See if this resembles joy.
Yeah, here we go. As long as our tech works, which it's not right now.
I love this opening riff so much.
I don't hear it.
I'm just going to hog it all myself then.
There we go. You got it?
I got it. You're in the game. Don't worry. You didn't miss much. I won't spoil
Ready
anything.
Ready Player Two. Definitely dig that riff.
So how do you feel about it being just a wee bit scratchy? You know, it's clearly a little bit rushed. It's clearly a little bit lo-fi, whether deliberately or as a constraint of the technology.
I think
that
talks to their punk roots. I mean, this is punk, right? Like, it's raw, it's dirty, it's not highly refined like some of their other albums down the road.
But don't you think a song like this, which is more scaled up production, how's this any different than what you would hear on End of the State or Take Your Pants Off?
Yeah, I mean, you're probably right, but just like anybody starting out, sort of have to cut your teeth and then you figure out production along the way.
But that's like it's a big debate, right? I mean, you can hear established artists deliberately go for a lo-fi noise, right? So then is lo-fi a sign of not making it yet? Or is it a sign of something else completely different?
I think it could be either, really. I mean, I think here, this is a sign of not having made it yet. And then the next album, Enema of the State, mm-hmm. is highly refined.
Right.
Maybe not highly refined like California is, like that to me is.
But you wouldn't hear a song sound like this.
Oh, no, definitely not.
You wouldn't, their vocals that. Would be mic'd differently.
Right, right.
Not to mention, separate from the production, but like the drumming, and I know we're gonna offend some Blink heads with this. I don't know it for sure. I didn't go like to the Blink subreddit or anything to verify this, but you just know there's like Scott Rayner fans who are like, just
purists.
It all changed for me when Travis came in Scott left. Just like,
stop listening to Blink.
This song would have been so much better if Scott Rayner was doing the boo, boo, boo.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know. I'm not gonna lie. When I like hear the Buddha and the Cheshire songs, I swear all I hear Scott doing the whole time is just boo, 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 boo.
I mean, that's punk drumming though. Like that's fast, you know, dirty. That's punk drumming.
And that's Travis came in, it's pop drumming. He's just so corporate.
Well, Travis is very technical. Like he's probably one of the best drummers in the game.
Yeah.
Like top to bottom.
And that's really like one of the biggest dividers, right, of punk and pop punk, besides like all the pomp and circumstance and just the pure money invested in it, is technical ability. The whole premise of punk is DIY.
Right.
That people with limited resources and limited ability can have a seat at the table.
Yeah,
so it encourages that type of drumming that is simplistic in nature and it's based more off of just raw energy.
Definitely. And that's why, I mean, nobody would consider Blink-182 a punk band now. They're pop punk. I mean, they are very pop.
So do you think that between Cheshire and, at what point did they officially cross the line? And they went from punk to pop punk. Is that between Dude Ranch and Enema?
What was the song I was telling you the other day where I heard it? Well, yeah, Damn It is definitely a good crossover song. Dumpweed, I would think, is a pretty good crossover song. But there was one I was texting you about. I'm like, oh, this is the song to me that is the line.
I thought it was Damn It.
Was it?
Because like, it was a standout song on Dude Ranch.
Yeah, which that's not even.
I guess we got to say for the Dude Ranch pod. And, but, right.
And Dude Ranch is between this and.
Yeah.
So it's I messed that up.
It's like the olive branch in between, though, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I mean, this is definitely as close to their roots as possible. And like, I'm sure like it kind of embodies what their live shows must have felt like, which must have been sick.
It must have been awesome.
In San Diego.
That whole like skateboard culture and the small clubs. And
must have been unreal.
Their reverence. I mean, it had to be a lot of fun.
And they were going up to LA and San Fran and Vegas and just getting as many shows as they could. Imagine just going to like some of the, well, I don't know if I could imagine it, my corporate sensibilities.
That's right.
Going to some of the legendary punk music venues in San Francisco.
They would
just
kick us out. They would just turn us around and get out of here before you get hurt.
I don't even know if we'd be able to get to the door.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
I mean, we get beat up by 14-year-olds so fast.
Some punk 14-year-olds. They have a strict no corpo rule. It says it right above the door.
Yeah, like, can't you read corpo?
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, I read at a 12th grade level. Excuse you.
All right,
let's do so many Excel
photos. Let's jump forward to M&M's or else this podcast is going to be 7 hours long. Mm. All right, M&M's.
I'm shooting for six, but let's keep moving. So I think this was Mark's attempt at one of his like first true love songs. There's only one masturbatory reference in the song.
Yeah,
only one.
Right. I know.
That's pretty
it's
sparse.
It's a little light. Got to bump those numbers up.
Yeah, I think he was trying to be tasteful about it.
Yeah.
What do you think about Mark's voice?
I like Mark's voice.
What do you think about it here and in general? Because it's not quite where it's going to end up being here. It's still kind of at its early days.
Yeah. No, I think here it's very solid. I mean,
gun to your head, Mark or Tom's voice?
I'd probably say Mark.
Me too.
Yeah.
It's not easy for me. No. Like, I don't make that choice lightly.
They both have good songs.
Yeah. I love the songs where they can interplay with each other. They don't do that much on Cheshire Cat or Buddha. They don't have that vocal interplay.
There was one song, again, I don't have my notes in front of me because I'm a rookie here.
You're a hack.
My notes.
You're a corporate hack, but also podcast
hack. Mostly hack.
And you learned it from
Let's
me.
Let's be honest, mostly hack.
Well, you know, I think it was because Mark, I don't know if he still is or how long he was, but he was a chain smoker at this stage.
Oh, yeah.
So he'd get winded, understandably, from the type of singing he was doing.
Could you imagine the energy on stage?
Yeah, so there's a lot of movement and singing. He's absolutely out of breath. He's a chain smoker, has no cardiovascular ability. So he's like, Tom, come on and get the next one.
I need a break. I need to breathe.
And Tom's like, oh, I'm so sorry. You think that when they met, which they got introduced, like, it's kind of weird how they met. They're like
really
3 years apart.
Yeah.
Like, Tom was 16 or something. And then Mark's like this 19, 20-year-old dude in community college. He's like, hey, I never thought I'll play alone. And it's like introduced by, it was like Tom's sister or something.
I'm breaking the story.
It was just like, hey, you're totally going to be friends with like this 20-year-old guy.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, age differences.
You want to be in my band?
He doesn't, like, age differences don't like matter beyond a certain age. Like, what's the difference between like a 30-year-old and a 33-year-old or a 40-year-old and 40?
Right?
There's literally nothing. They're
but
the
like
same
a
people.
20 and a 16-year-old?
That's like
a big difference.
That's like a 20-year difference.
Yeah, that's a big difference. Yeah.
Right, like, I wonder what the dynamics were. It's like, did Mark invite him over? And then he was probably still like living with his mom at the time.
At least there's somebody that could buy him beer, you know?
Well, not even.
Well, that's true.
It's like, you're old and you can't buy me beer.
Jump right into Ben Doosler.
Did we give M&M's its proper due?
No, but we're into it anyway, so.
So is this pronounced Fent Fenter
Oozler.
Or, oh, I put the L in the wrong place. Mm. Fentuzler. Like in one swift motion?
Loser.
Or do you like really separate like Fent Oozler?
Yeah, I think it's Fent Oozler.
Oh, wow, you're really hitting that ooze.
Ooh. Yeah, it's double O.
It is a double O. I'm saying Fentuzler.
Yeah.
So what is a Fentuzler?
I don't know. How would I know?
I couldn't figure out the backstory in this one.
Yeah.
It's as mysterious as 182. It might not be.
No, I don't
maybe
think
the
it is.
Punks that beat us up in 1996 in San Francisco, they probably kicked, they probably punched me in the gut and then slapped you in the face. You were crying and I was puking.
And that's a Fentuzler.
And then they're like, yeah, how do you like that Fentuzler? I don't know. I mean, that wasn't really a deep voice, but they probably didn't even have that deep of a voice.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong. I think on Buddha, this was like a lot more Scott influence. Like, and there's backup vocals here.
Well, I mean, they loved bands like Pennywise,
yeah,
which totally. Was weird because like I didn't know much about Pennywise before I heard that they were an influence. I go and listen to them and I'm like, they sound nothing like Blink.
Yeah.
Because Pennywise is considered bro punk.
What it's punk?
Bro punk.
Bro punk.
Yeah, it's just a little more aggressive. Okay. It's not as happy-go-lucky as Blink. There was another bit more happy-go-lucky punk band active during the same years as Pennywise that influenced them. Oh, I can't remember the name of it. I have to pull up the Spotify.
Did you see the, I think it was Pennywise that brought Tony Hawk up and he was singing one of their songs?
Oh yeah, I mean, Tony is
viral,
making his rounds right now, man.
Which, they're probably all in that same area, right? Well, I think he was more LA though.
San Diego was where that was the skate capital of the country at the time.
Okay, so that
would
make
Blink
sense.
Really, and that was very deliberate on their part too. They deliberately positioned themselves in the middle of the skate community. Because, I mean, they really timed it up perfectly. Or, you know, right place, right time.
Yeah, right? I mean, it all comes together, right?
Yeah, I mean, there's plenty of bands out there at the same time who are playing this type of poppy speed punk. And
right.
They just weren't able to, A, have the right place, right time. And also, just put in the wild hours that these guys were.
Oh, yeah, I mean, what was the story where they were in college 2 days a week so that they could do like mini road trip tours, you know, every
weekend.
Yeah,
when Mark was a 29-year-old in community college and Tom was like a 9-year-old. Yeah,
yeah, I mean, yeah.
It was crazy. But yeah, he was scheduling his classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays so that he'd have tour availability. Mm-hmm. But he got to a point where they were just getting offered more tour dates across the Southwest part of America. And he had to go to his mom and be like, all right, either with the band and I focus on college, or I delay college and I focus only the band. And credit to his mom,
yeah,
a freaking bro.
I heard this was like
an absolute bro. She's I can't believe, like,
legend status for mom.
She's like, college will always be here, you only get a chance to be in a band once.
Yeah,
what, like, mom of the decade, dude.
Yeah, legend.
We need more moms like that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Follow your dreams. Follow your heart, and all your dreams will come true.
Shout out to the moms, and like,
yeah, for sure,
the MILFs too.
Oh yeah,
there's overlap, but like,
there's definitely lots of overlap.
Yeah, but those are two key groups in society.
Yeah,
I appreciate them both.
Yeah, so we've moved on to Touchdown Boy now. Definitely more speed punk.
And now we're starting to get some of the
skits and the antics,
which, I mean, I like that they did it because it's representative of their live show. Like, you listen to the Mark, Tom, and Travis show, and there's just so much riffing in between songs.
I love that.
And they just, I feel pretty confident it's all off the cuff.
Oh,
I
yeah, I'm
think
sure.
They just bounce off each other in that way, the way that only an 8-year-old and a 33-year-old man can.
And I wonder, you know, coming into this show in, it's May, right? May 16th is our date, I think.
It's somewhere there.
If they're going to have that same, like, that riffing and that
they
same,
got to,
like,
right?
I would think so.
I think it would almost, it'd be, you know, it'd be sad if they did it.
I don't remember that when I saw them in, like, 2018. But
really?
Again, you know, it wasn't the original lineup, so maybe that spark wasn't there.
So they're just staying together for the kids now? Us
I
being the kids?
So. We are the kids.
Wow.
Yeah.
That would actually be really sad if They're just not.
I don't think that's the case.
It's just all cash grab.
Yeah, which.
They're more corporate than us.
Yeah. I mean, the amount we paid for those tickets, thank you, Ticketmaster.
That's why we're doing the prep right now.
It was a freaking cash grab.
I need to emotionally invest in this so that that money will one day be worth it.
Ring every cent out of that ticket.
I have to, otherwise I won't be able to sleep at night.
But I mean, we had seats, but the floor was more expensive.
Well, I mean, it's a Blink concert.
I know, but it was like $600. It's like, what the hell? To stand for 3 hours.
I mean, I'm a big standing guy.
I mean, I'm a corpo.
You know me, I'm a corpo who likes to get my knees loose. I don't walk well the next day, but I'm a dancer.
It's all right.
At heart.
That's right. So what here we got here, Strings, man? Another
Strings
song
off
of
Buddha. That was a standout to me.
It was.
Yeah.
Definitely. Much more refined vocals in this version than the Buddha version.
Yeah.
There were a few times where he's singing Strings and I'm like,
yeah.
maybe we need to do a little, you know, editing of this or re-record that. But in this version, it's way better.
It's funny how we can sit here and say Mark's voice has come a long way, but it's kind of like a narrow range where he started in one place, and it's not like he sings that much differently today. Like, he takes advantage of the fact that if you listen to his podcast or his radio show, he just has a very natural, he's a radio voice.
Yeah.
It's just a this monotone, really nice tone.
Good timbre.
Yeah, great. Oh, oof. Wow. Good word.
Yeah.
You know, you're not as bad as they say you are.
Thank you.
Timber.
I have a couple, flashes of greatness. Not a lot. Maybe every three episodes.
I thought you just do it privately in the shrine room.
That's cool. That's where I write them all down so I can use them later.
Yeah, naked.
But
so he's got this great voice and he's just getting, all he had to do was just figure out how to elongate those tones.
Yeah.
Because he already had it.
Well, and then
get some actual emotion.
Three short years later, he's got it.
I mean, even just like Damn It. Damn It like was his best vocal performance up to that point.
Yeah.
I keep spoiling the Dude Ranch podcast.
I know.
I just keep thinking about Damn It, man.
I know.
It's a perfect.
That's
it's a damn perfect
the line.
Song.
God, damn it is the line.
Song.
Damn it.
Peggy Sue,
here we go.
Now, this is one that upon first listen, I couldn't tell you anything about this one. Wasn't a standout, so we'll see how this time around goes. Do you think that our listeners just want to stab us?
Probably. Who are these hats?
In both our heart on this side and the heart on this side, because humans have two hearts, because we're just talking over all their favorite songs.
Yeah.
This is like the biggest Scott Rainer fans, like, let Rainer do his thing. He's trying to make it Rainer.
In the back of their heads, all they're thinking are, man, these freaking hacks. And joke's on you. Because we are hacks, and we admit it. So,
what do you want me to do? What would you have me do? I'm a corporate hack.
Come on.
Yeah.
Anyway,
just let Rainer bang. Yeah. Let him do his thing. Travis comes along, and he ruins the sanctity of Blink. It's like, whoa, Blink's a funk band from Europe,
right,
buddy?
Yeah.
We don't even like
he joined later on. Rainer went to Blink and Funk.
Did he?
No.
He always struck me as a funk guy.
Yeah.
You're not funk rock.
This drumming is
funk
very
rock.
Funk.
I want to like
pop punk.
I want to think of like all the
pop funk.
In the alternate funk rock universe, like what's Henry Rollins' like funk name? What are all the punk icons?
Yeah. I don't know. So
you can even hear like in a song like Peggy Sue, it's we were talking about this the other day. It's all there. It's all there. There's their grasp of melody. It's all there. What's so funny about them is that their lyrics are rarely sentimental, but every use of melody is sentimental. I don't know if it's subconscious or deliberate, but it's very sentimental lyrics. They always choose the chord progressions that are typically emotion evokers. They're not trying, like, and we know that they were never trying to do the punk rock thing of let's not sign to a major label, let's not be big. They wanted their music to be heard by as many people as possible. So, I mean, I don't know how deliberate it was, like their choice of chord progressions. I would like to think that they just chose the ones that made them feel good. And that to me is like ironic because of how guarded they were, and they're always doing their type of, you know, potty humor on stage and whatever, but they're playing like incredibly sentimental melodies. It was always like a funny contradiction with them for me, and part of why I love them.
Well, exactly. I mean, they're corpo. I mean, look at how successful they are, right?
Yeah.
But they're also so punk. I mean, they defined this whole genre. I mean, there's a lot of groundwork that was laid by a lot of other bands, but Blink is, in my opinion, the standout. They are, if somebody said, what's pop punk? Blink 182. And then I'd even go, you know, a decade later, Fall Out Boy, which, you know, we can get into them at some other point. But
I agree with almost everything except for, nah, nobody did anything before Blink. Pennywise wasn't worth a nickel.
No, I'm just kidding.
I'm not here to upset the Pennywise fans. But you're right. Everybody's just a product of their influences. And I wonder...
I mean, they're not the first to be doing this in the scene in California.
No, of course not. I think they work the network better than anybody else.
Oh, I think that they definitely do. Else. Especially in that era, like so much word of mouth. How hard is it to get an audience just by word of mouth? No social media, you know, no airplay on the radio. I mean, that had to be much more difficult than today's artists garnering fans through trendy videos and, you know, social media posts.
Yes, they were having to go to physical buildings.
They had to talk to you.
What?
To make you a fan.
I don't know if 1996 me would have been able to talk to them, but
yeah, it's pretty impressive. They probably wouldn't have talked to us.
No, I mean, after we got black eyes,
right?
Got puke dribble on my chin, and my shirt, like, what happened? I was like, I just got back from San Francisco, rough trip. And they're like, look, a Fentuzler. Then
they
just freaking deck me, dude.
Yep.
Get us worse than that 14-year-old. And then that's coming from Tom DeLong, a fucking 13-year-old. It's like, who's your 40-year-old friend? Gosh.
So here we go. Does my breath smell?
Things got real punk there for a second because the last song sometimes was 1 minute and 8 seconds long. Honestly, too punk. We're on the punk meter right now.
That is super punk. A minute? I mean, that is... That's punk.
That's uber punk.
Yeah, the shorter the song, the more punk it is.
I agree. Like, I want to see the 1 second punk song.
Yeah.
Just like a guy screaming naked in a room. Yeah. That's just all it is. Now, that would be absolutely punk rock. Just anybody can do it.
Yeah.
Well, not everybody can be the naked guy, but everybody can scream in a bedroom, but not everybody can have a bedroom. So I don't want to limit the scope of this.
Are you talking about what you do at night?
In my shrine room?
Yeah. Yes.
Listen, I didn't want to come out with it.
Scream into the
darkness.
Do
I or do I not have a shrine room?
You already outed me for my shrine room.
Well, something tells me that was an open invitation. You're like, hey, everybody, I got a shrine room.
Everyone wants to get naked.
You more or less doxed yourself with that one.
Yeah.
I don't mean to dox you. We are at your house right now.
That's true.
And your social security number is? Floor is yours. Take a sir.
Good try.
Next time.
Yeah.
After this commercial break. So does my breath smell?
This podcast brought to you by Cutwater.
And Miller High Life. Let's get that in the shot. Do better cinema mode. Was it truly refreshing?
It was.
So do you think that this question, the name of the song, does my breath smell, is it rhetorical? Who do you think it was directed at?
I think they want to know.
Who do you think they were? Everyone has a muse when they're writing, right? I always find that interesting. When people write songs, some people, they say, well, I'm writing it. It's like a letter. I'm directing at someone. It's like a conversation, a one-way conversation. Sounds like an argument you have in your head on an airplane. Like, that's what that sounds like to me. And then some people, they're writing to themselves. Some people are writing even more abstractly. They're just writing about things that they see and feel. I would wonder with Mark and Tom splitting up the songwriting duties, how they would do that.
Yeah.
Like, what is
their muse? It'd be interesting to see, like, you know, in the room when they were writing some of these things and figuring out the chord progressions and the
lyrics. You gotta think there was just some ad-libbing. Like, they had the chord progressions down, the lyrics absolutely came last. They were definitely just saying a bunch of cuss words over melodies to figure out what
notes they wanted to hit. Then they added some regular words and this is how they...
But seriously, though, like, that's... If you told me it happened any other way, I'd be blown away. I think they were just riffing and those are the progressions they liked. And then they hummed and cussed words over it. and then they slotted in actual words where the cuss words were.
Hmm.
I mean, if there's been times at live shows where...
I can't refute that. It sounds right.
Can you just imagine it? There's been times where Tom's had to riff at live shows, and I mean, I don't know how much we care about cussing on this show. If we're ever going to be sponsored by like a baby diaper company or something, like
then we care.
I've been lobbying so hard to be sponsored by a baby diaper company.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we should cuss here.
Are you sure not adult diapers?
I thought that was a big fucking mistake. I mean, I think we can get big in the adult diaper market.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, do you think
we'll lower the demographic for that. We'll bring it to the 30-year-olds. It's not just for 60-year-olds.
30-year-olds that need dye-dyes?
Yeah.
Like, are they just going to New Year's Eve parties every day of the year?
No, it's just...
They're like on a Gregorian calendar.
It's just the way they want to live.
Calendar.
No, they just, every day. They just want to wear a diaper.
Put on their dye-dye?
Yeah.
Who's changing it?
I mean, they are, I think. Or maybe not, I don't know.
You don't know. They might have a very open relationship.
Yeah.
What song we got on here, Matt?
So, we are on track 9 of 16.
On Cheshire Cat. If you're just now joining us on a podcast.
Yeah. You know, for me, it's, and we've talked about it before, like, I listen to these songs all the time. I listen to the same songs over and over again because I love them.
We get it. Your ears work.
But a lot of them, I don't know the names of them. I just like, you know, if I looked at it, I'd be like, oh yeah, that's that song.
Oh yeah.
But if you're like, hey, what song are you listening to right now? I'd be like, I don't know. I don't
that's
know.
That's not a Blink thing for me either. That applies to
everybody.
All
that's what I mean.
Music listening for me. Yeah. That also, like, did I forget your name for a second? Absolutely.
It happens to me all the freaking time.
You ever have that issue where you forget someone's name?
I've met you 25 times, but is your name Mike or Mark?
Gotta have those catch-alls. Buddy,
yeah,
friend,
exactly.
What's up, dude?
Exactly.
You don't have those. I think society and the nuclear family would dissolve as we know it.
True.
Before our eyes. If everybody knew we didn't remember each other's names, society would cease.
Hey, I'm Matt.
Fuck you, dude.
All right.
I'm going to introduce you to my friends, San Francisco.
Ooh.
Rough you
just,
up.
Just
that
the 14-year-olds, though. So here we are with TV, another song off of Buddha. Definitely a rawer, more punk.
Mm. We're coming up to our big one here in a few songs.
Toast and Bananas.
What you refer to as Adam's song's daddy. I don't want to spoil which one that is, though. See if the listeners can figure out which one that is.
You could hear it, right?
Yeah. No, it's definitely
the driving bass.
It's not at the onset. The song gets ramped up a little.
Yeah, it's a little bit into it.
We'll see if we identify the same moment. We'll see if we're on the same page with that.
Okay.
And if we're not, this podcast is fucking over. Yeah. It's just done.
Pack it up, Ethan.
Why are we doing
it? We're done.
Clearly, our ears don't work the same.
And I never want to talk to you again.
Yeah, I mean, you don't think everything I think? I don't want to talk to you.
Unbelievable.
I'll have a better conversation with myself in my shrine room. Fuck.
Yeah.
Did I just
admit? You're not invited. Everybody else is invited. You are not invited to the shrine room.
You know, I'm not a populist like you inviting everyone to my shrine room. It's a private place where I worship at the feet of Rob Thomas of Matchbox 20 and John Resnick of the Goo Goo Dolls.
Yeah.
So why don't you just leave me alone and let me shout 3 a.m.
Okay.
At the bottom of my lungs.
Okay. Bottom of your lungs.
Yeah. That's how deep they are for
just
me.
Like,
I let Rob in.
It's 3 a.m. I must be lonely. Okay, Toast and Bananas.
I personally...
Track 11.
Don't toast my bananas, but if I put toast and bananas together... Oh, yes!
You this freaking song. You have something to say, Ethan.
Can you please play that song again?
Yeah, let's start
play
this
again
bad
for the
boy
listeners
over.
Too. The beginning of this song, tell me, listener, what it sounds like.
Here we go.
Is that not?
Give it a sec.
Can I make it any more obvious?
Absolutely.
It's a Skater Boy.
It is Skater Boy, for sure.
And there's no way it was an accident. There's no way. It was only 6 years apart, right? There's no way this is an accident.
They repackaged this and then sold it to us. But we were talking about this the other day. I never got the chance to look up to see if there's a writing credit out there. for Blink.
Yeah, I didn't check either.
It'd be really interesting to find that out. Which, I mean,
I just wonder if
I have Google search, Google machine in front of me here.
I mean, you do have a device. Some would say a tool in front of you that would help you dig such answers. I would have to think that, yeah, just Toast and Bananas Skater Boy should yield some results. There's no way we're the only people that think this. Everyone must think this.
Right there, Reddit, number one.
Reddit's always got the answers, but don't fall into a wormhole into the Scott Rayner subreddit. It's a danger zone there.
Yeah. I mean, so obviously we're not the only ones thinking this.
Yeah. I mean, this is a little alarming for me. I thought I was the only one in the world that had original thoughts. So it's a little unnerving to know that other people are allowed to have thoughts this side of the Mississippi.
Let's see. Skater Boy writing credit.
Well, during hour three of this podcast, we'll make sure to dig into Avril Lavigne's debut album in 2002. And we'll also discuss clone theory. So is there anything other than just fan theory slash graphic fan fiction regarding this? And I imagine it's graphic fan fiction.
It'd be interesting.
Ooh, there's a great guitar solo in the song. It's effing fantastic.
There.
Look at me excusing my language. That was professional.
I don't see anything. We might have to dig into this a little bit deeper and maybe put it as like a note on the...
It just seems too coincidental.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
If it was many more years apart, I wouldn't even think anything of it. But to both be kind of like in the pop punk realm.
Yeah.
Just seems too on the nose. But then again, like,
all right,
who was listening to Cheshire Cat in 2002?
True.
Well, I don't know. I mean, a lot of Blink heads out there, even more Rainer heads. Rain Dogs? We'll call them Rain Dogs. We'll call them the Raincoats. So what do we got here?
We got Wasting Time.
See, once again, like, it was all there, man.
Yeah.
It's all there. Like, just a little bit more clean of production. This, to me, fits on any album, Enema of the State onward. Well, Dude Ranch as well, of course, because Dude Ranch was still like on their up and up.
I don't know if I love the snare though. Like, I wish it was tuned a little bit different on this one.
Well, I mean, we know how we feel about Rainer.
Right.
I think we'd always take Travis's drumming over his. This podcast does not solely exist to stick it to Scott, okay?
No.
I want to make that clear.
Whatever happened, like, I guess I didn't really...
He was pretty much out after they made the decision, signed to, I think it was MCA for Enema. And he wanted to go with Epitaph, a legendary indie label in California at the time, best known for, like, Rancid and insert other notable punk band here, yada, yada, yada. He really wanted that. They took the bigger money deal with MCA. They claimed other reasons, but I think money was a pretty big factor. And I get it. Like, MCA had a bigger distribution network. And their biggest thing was, so long as we can maintain artistic autonomy, they were looking for the greatest combination of artistic autonomy, which they needed 100%.
Right.
And the biggest distribution network. MCA was able to give them both. And a far bigger distribution network than Epitaph. So... I mean, how could I blame them?
Yeah.
Really That's can. What they wanted.
Yeah. I mean, it was obviously the right decision.
Yeah. But Scott stuck around for about, I think, a year or so after that decision was made. But I'm pretty sure, if I remember correctly, he definitely didn't play Enema at all. He was out before they recorded Enema.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure you're right.
I wonder what he's up to now. And he's kind of like Pete Best. Related to the Beatles.
Best of the Beatles.
It's not quite at the same scale.
No.
Like, Blink has made, I mean, millions of dollars in the bank, but not the number of millions that Paul McCartney has in the bank. Right. But let's just, I'd say it's comparable enough to where Scott definitely wakes up in the morning and he either has a really hard look at the mirror or he can't look in the mirror.
Yeah.
That's a tough morning.
I mean, those are tough decisions to make, though, when you're like early 20s, right?
Oh, like, yeah. When you're just when like, you're like the stupidest person in the world.
Well, yeah, exactly. And you think like that you're the smartest person.
Time.
Yeah. And you think you're the smartest person in the world. And you think this is the way it's got to go. And I can't, you know, make any concessions on it.
I always think about like age. You could argue at this for any age, like between 19 and maybe 22. It's like the inflection point of self-confidence and you've never thought you were smarter. There's never been a bigger gap between what you think you are and what you are than during that like 3-year period. So the fact that every popular musician there ever was, for the most part, got famous, you know, close to that time frame, or maybe like, you know, expanded a little bit, 1925. It's just unbelievable to me. It's wild that people made enough of the right decisions to be in a spot when they were that at that inflection point where there was never been a bigger gap between what they thought they were and what they were.
Yeah.
It's wild. But I guess that might, you could argue that would help. That level of delusion could help you.
Yeah, I mean, it's a tool. You're not even thinking about what other people are thinking about you. I mean, you just don't care. Yeah.
You got the answers.
Yeah.
So take us through your musical career during that time frame where you were that level of delusional.
So early 20s, I kind of knew at that point I wasn't going to make it playing. I'd been in a band in high school, and then kind of come out of that when I went to college. The band sort of broke up. Everyone did their own
thing. Yeah, after your rehab stint.
Right. Second rehab stint.
Yeah, that was a rough go.
Yeah. And
you still owe a lot of people a lot of apologies.
That's true. So expect a phone call from the internet.
Yeah. I mean, I'd say you could do it here, but it'd be a little crass.
It's true. We can't rush this.
No.
It's only been 20 years.
Everybody, meet Matt in the Shrine Room.
Yeah.
If you want.
That's where you'll get your apology.
Yeah.
And then after I sort of realized that I wasn't going to make it, I'm like, well, I'm business oriented. I'm a corpo.
Big corpo.
Yeah. Maybe I can help other bands make it. And, you know, I had varying degrees of success. And one band in particular, I thought we did a pretty good job and just sort of got to the point where, you know, we recorded three albums, I think. And I was really happy with the way they came out. And it just sort of, I think, kind of fizzled, you know, like everybody had such high hopes. And then it just didn't get anywhere. You know, we had some, you know, decent contacts and just started to have some doors closing in our faces. And then everybody got a little bit older, started families, started careers, became corpos, and the band kind of went their separate ways. So, and here I am now after that. That ended in like 08, and now
several character arcs removed.
Yeah. And now here we are having a podcast about music.
Yeah. Well, bands for hire. Matt's looking to manage. He told me privately that he'd like to take on a minimum of 3 at once. That's kind of his sweet spot.
Yeah, definitely.
4 would be nice.
Yeah, right? Shoot us an email.
Yeah, you've got ample time.
Yeah.
I think we're going to have lots to go back to Romeo and Rebecca because we didn't do our test, our Adam song test.
And I think that for whatever reason, it like skipped it.
I think we just got deep in the weeds your musical trauma.
Because there was some silence there for a little bit.
I think that was the white noise in your head as you were reliving repressed memories.
It was tinnitus from managing all those bands.
Yeah.
Doing all those shows. But all right, let's just head back now.
Yeah, let's do it.
What do you say?
We don't got to listen to the full thing, but we got to do the Adam song test.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to say, I'll let you know when I think I hear Adam's song, and then you let me know if it confirms when you thought you heard it. Everybody stay quiet. Everybody be so quiet. Shut up. Yep, there it is.
Yep. definitely.
Unmistakably.
Yeah.
Just have to, got to get through that initial entry point.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Romeo and Rebecca.
There it is. Everybody that's listening to us heard it already, but we didn't highlight it. So.
And they were all just screaming at their phone. Adam Song, you corporate hacks.
I can't hear you.
If you would stop talking about your BS for 1 second, you would know this is Adam Song. Yeah,
this is Adam Song's daddy.
Can you believe?
It's not even Adam Song.
That
Adam
5 years daddy. Later, some funk band in Europe ripped off this song to write some song called like Amy Song or Andrew Song or something. Adam Song?
Yeah.
Some Blink band ripped them off.
Oh yeah, geez.
No credit or anything.
So we got Skater Boy on this album.
There's a hit list developing.
Yeah.
I'll let my friends at San Francisco, well, they're not quite friends, but acquaintances in San Francisco know about this.
So here we go. We're going to go just about done. And we're almost, we are just about
I appreciate done. That, by the way.
Yeah.
I like that. You know, you're skipping through the album and then it's like just about
it there. It can't be the last song because it would be done.
Well, this is the penultimate track. You hear that? What a word. Penultimate definitely track.
A lot of Van Halen feel there.
Yeah. This is.
Is that hash pipe?
This is. We're getting to the point of the album where they're just gripping it and ripping it, huh?
They're like, I know we said we were gonna do 16 songs, but I really don't want to do 16 songs.
I know we promised 16 songs to our Lord and Savior, whoever that may be.
Yeah, right.
It's not for us to say, but it seems like this might not be a song.
No, I know. I don't think so. But here we are, 55 seconds deep.
Yeah, but we're just about done.
Yeah. And on that note, let's go to Depends. Speaking of adult diapers.
Oof. We got to make inroads, man. We got to make some inroads on the adult diaper market.
Yeah. We're open to offers, Depends, or any other manufacturer of adult diapers.
As people
we need
become
some sponsorships.
It's less and less reasons.
I'm shameless. I'll put it out there.
Yeah? You can only promote what you use and trust,
me,
right?
If they're paying me, you know, who's to say?
Hey, send me some products.
He'll model it for you too. He's only gonna wear that on the Dude Ranch episode.
Yeah, send me some Depends. I will model it for the Dude Ranch episode. And I mean, promo code hold my spot.
Yeah.
Or promo code change my diapy. Like we could, from one corpo to another, we could do business.
So we've got, about 55 minutes on this podcast right now.
Allegedly, that's the metric system that we're going off of here.
That's way longer than I thought this was going to be.
How long is the album?
Total?
Don't tell me it's like 3 minutes and we just
41 minutes and 55 seconds.
Okay, so we meandered a bit
at the beginning. Yeah, a little bit, but pretty concise. Only about 10 minutes of meandering.
Some concise meandering.
Yeah.
So this closing track, by the way. It's pretty appropriate.
Yeah.
That it just ends now. Music cut. Trying to make out what they're hearing.
It's okay, there we go. So there we go.
Hold on.
Take another sip of some cut water here.
Yeah, labels out, finish up. There we go, cinematic. You got it, nailed it. And that wraps up Cheshire Cat.
Yeah.
The 1995 offering from Blink-182, formerly known as Blink. there you have it, folks.
Yeah. So successful second episode, first album review.
Well, that's not for us to decide.
No.
The success part. This could be a colossal failure that could end with the loss or resignation from both of our jobs.
And it could be a straight up lawsuit from Blink-182 for just live streaming their album.
Yeah, I mean, I think they'd be less offended by the infringement and more so by just the complete neglect of every song that played.
Our complete lack of insight into what they were trying to do.
There was a distinct lack of insight and attentiveness. Yeah. Yeah, they'll have to decide what they're more offended by. Obviously, they're avid listeners.
Yeah.
Mark and Tom are friends. We discuss Depends all the time. You know, Mark in his advanced age, we're talking quite a bit about things like changing diapers.
Yeah. Yeah, it just makes sense.
But yeah. So here we go. So what's next?
So next, stay tuned, I guess, for Dude Ranch, right? And
yeah.
And then after that, we're going to build up to our pinnacle, our Everest for the Blink-182 lineup.
That's our inflection point.
Yeah, definitely.
It's like we're both climbing different sides of the same mountain. It's me at the top.
And state.
Maybe that's like a joint shrine room at the top. It's kind of a beautiful thing.
I think you're right.
I'm not going to be naked at the top of Mount Everest.
All right, just waist down.
Circulation issues.
To be totally naked, just waist down.
Yeah. Winnie the Pooh it?
Yeah.
You want to Winnie the Pooh it on Everest, bro?
Yeah,
I'm trying to poo it on Everest. We can poo it on Everest. But yeah, we've got some concerts coming up. I think we've got one on February 18th.
Yep, Future Teens.
We've got a couple in March.
Yep.
Hot Mulligan in the lineup.
Hot Mulligan, super excited.
Wonder Years.
That'll
Carly
be my
Cosgrove.
Second time seeing Hot Mulligan.
This guy.
Yeah, I know. Hey, he's I offered you free tickets and you didn't come.
He's going to be managing them all in no time.
Yeah.
We get it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's going to be pretty sweet.
I'm excited.
It's the best Christmas gift I got.
Yeah.
Tickets to go
Merry
see
Christmas.
Hot Mulligan.
A sold out show in Columbus, Ohio.
It's another one of our, it's a budding inflection point for us. The
it
same
is.
Way that Blink is, you know, a clear cut inflection point for us. We've both agreed on Hot Mulligan
grew
for some
up
time.
On it. Yeah.
And we don't agree on much, people. This is actually the 47th take of this episode. and around take 33, after we got into fisticuffs and we had to put some makeup on the eye here, I called up my wife and I said, please come pick me up because my license was revoked. But we worked through it.
We've been trying to record this since our last episode came out over 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
So this is it.
Right.
I mean.
You know, like old money and new money. We're like old corporate. We're like, we don't know technology well enough to like fully...
Well, this experience has been eye-opening for me at how much better you are at this than I am. And you're 33.
Wow.
I am 37.
I am 30.
You are 30.
That was...
So even more so, how much better you are at this.
I don't have enough facial hair to justify that.
That's true. And so, next time you folks see me, it's fully gone.
He almost certainly based that age guess off of my diaper status. Which you can't quite see because I'm self-conscious and hiding it, but you can see the outline of my Depends
diaper user.
I'm trying to make inroads here.
All right.
I'm trying to make inroads here, and he's saying I have an advanced age, like I'm making friends with some 13-year-old punk in San Diego, California, 1993, because my sister told me that we should play in a band together.
Are you done? All right, everybody. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed this second episode and this, I don't know, in-depth maybe or whatever.
We should probably never use the word depth around us.
At Cheshire Cat.
But yeah, so. If you had a good time, please come on back. We'll make sure to hold your spot.